Hello, malty. Monothistledic. Can I start again? Thank you. Hello, malty. Monotheistic milesters of malt mentoring. And thank you to Sam Gruber for that malt mention for Ralfy Review 823 Extras. The extras, of course, is in conjunction with specific in-depth reviews of good quality spirits, mainly single malts, because that's what I have around me. That's what I have most access to. And at the moment, there's quite a number of really interesting, good quality American spirits that I'd love to have access to, but I can't buy them where I am. So I'll just have to wait, because I do not accept free samples, because it just works better that way. There's no expectations and there's no slide into overt subliminal marketing. And that's quite important. So, in the meantime, what am I going to talk about? I know, nostalgia. Nostalgia is something which affects everybody who is into good quality spirits. Because whether it be whiskey, malt blended, Japanese whiskey, Irish whiskey, rum, bourbon, rye, tequila, we all have a connection with these spirits back in our past. Some of them were quite hostile, for example, in knocking back the shots of cheap tequila and dehydrating as a result, because one happened to be in a hot environment, whether it be in a bar or in the tropics or in Mexico or somewhere. But we all have these memories and associations with spirits, which are amplified and made all the greater by the fact that smell and taste are interpreted and stored by the brain subjectively and emotionally in all parts of the brain. So the memory of a good whiskey or a great bourbon at a rodeo, for example, or a mint julep at the Kentucky Derby, that flavour is with you forever, with us forever, and we never really forget it, because when we come across that flavour again in another context in many years' time, it triggers. And I want you to be kind of really aware of that, because sometimes you might yourself wondering, what does this taste of? What am I smelling here? And you'll find that it's not something that you're familiar with now, but you were when in your much younger days. Say, for example, specific types of confectionery that are no longer available in the market. So there's this nostalgia thing going on, and it's really quite intense. And what we can do is we can turn it to our advantage, because the majority of folk who don't use their senses very much and are quite lazy, because people can be lazy, very lazy. And it's a tragedy to watch people around us who are lazy in life. It's not that they didn't use their senses, they didn't use anything. They just preferred to sit and vegetate. And it doesn't happen suddenly, it happens gradually, methodically over time. And this is one reason why old people look so old, because they have allowed it to happen. We've got to keep our mind active, and this is why we want to be conscious and aware of things like subjectivity and smell and taste and nostalgia and how it affects us. And I'm going to give you one working example of this, just to put it into context, because as much as the casual drinker will have a throwback to a throw up many years ago when they were young and foolish and silly and a student probably and getting drunk in tequila and cheap, shitty, chemical beer and talking crap because young people do, it's real life. In later years, even in a cocktail, that hint of tequila can bring it all crashing back into the memory. Even the people that were there, the colours of clothes, the circumstances, the location. And it's something that the single malt drinker understands and uses to their advantage. And I'm going to, here we go with Bunahabin. I've just reviewed Bunahabin for the third time in 10 years. And I reviewed it back in 2010, not long after I started as a whisky reviewer, in Ralfy Review 150. And it was a bottle like this that I reviewed, one of the older, that older generation of bottling, and it was still at 40%. And I mentioned in my previous video, 823, how much Buna has meant to me because it's the first single malt that I sipped slowly on its own. And the reason I did that was because I was drinking rum and tonic before I got into whiskey. But when I bought my own flat in Glasgow in a place called Partick, I was beside all these local pubs and the people working in the whiskey industry were going to these bars. In fact, I talk about it in my book, Search for Whiskey Bothy, and particularly in chapter two. And it was very, very, I can remember the bars, I can remember, in fact, the wonderful thing is, I could actually go on a plane later this year and fly back there and go into these same bars, and I'll see the same people, the same characters, because the place has changed so little over 50 years. And 40 years, sorry. 40 to 50 years. But Bunahabin was the first bottle that I was given as a gift, and because I ran out of dark rum, I used the whiskey instead with the tonic, and then gradually there was less tonic, and so I'd use some water, and then less water, and then I started tasting the damn stuff. And that's when everything changed. That is when my whole whiskey world started to open up, and we all have that one bottle where it all started. It could be Glenfiddich 12-year-old, and you could be into whiskey occasionally, but suddenly you encountered that Glendronach 15-year-old revival, which I'll be reviewing again before too long. And it was a game changer. That experience, whether you're just starting or you've been hesitating a little bit, intermittent tasting of single malts, and then suddenly you just have that moment, that defining nostalgic moment, which is very intense. I mean, even looking at this bottle now, I can remember it sitting in a wooden varnished gantry shelf up at the top with the dust around it because nobody was buying it because folk were going to the for the house blends and bells. And I was getting it in the bar for £1 a dram, and it was a 35mm measure, not 25. And I'd sit there with a pint and you'd be listening to people and there was no television and you'd have conversations with strangers. So I can remember all the smell, the faint smell of when the toilet doors would open, you smell a little bit of the urine coming out. You'd smell the overbearing perfume of the ladies that were having their gin and tonics and lemon in it and tall glasses with little lump bumps round it for the grip. Yeah, I remember all that. Very 70s, 80s. It was a 1980s bar using 1970s glassware. And the nostalgia when you go back with that bottle that you first memorably encountered, it's amazing how it animates that time and that place and that person who we are. And then, of course, we come up to the modern times, to contemporary times. And after reviewing Boone Haben 12-year-old in 2016. May 2016, Ralphy Review 574. Here I am at Ralphy Review 823. Reviewing Boone Haben for the third time, and it's still Boone Haben, but it's a different whiskey. Of course it is, because over the passage of time, just as we have changed, because we inevitably do, malt mates, so has the whiskey we drink. In two main ways. One, the increasing use of modern productive barley strains mean that it is more cost efficient and effective, and of course in demand by the distillers, because they get easy to work with malted barley that is highly productive and produces lots of alcohol and just enough flavour to define the character of the single malt, but certainly not the intensity and depth and range of flavours that you used to get from more primitive barleys years ago. That's a fact of it. This is why organic barleys and single source barleys such as Bruichladdy and Springbank are doing. That's why these are so important, people. They're so important to give us the opportunity, if we're prepared to pay the price, to get the experience of a less yielding variety of malted barley, which is delivering more grain flavour. And it's a simple equation. The more starch in that little barley seed, the more sugar you can generate, which is converted to alcohol. But the more starch, the less room for the endosperm, for the husk, for the other components of that barley seed that are not starch. And they contribute to flavour dramatically, particularly if the husk is allowed in. No more so than with peated whiskey, because the husk contains a lot of the peat. But also casks have changed. And this is something that concerns me, because I can see too much, not bad wood, but mediocre wood out in the industry. And fine, if they're putting it into blends, it really doesn't matter. But particularly for better quality single malts, you simply need a better quality cask for that. A sympathetic cask. And casks have changed. It's a much more industrial, mechanised process generally than it used to be. It's not so long ago that hundreds of coopers in the Scotch whisky industry were paid off, laid off and made redundant. And that was a disaster in Scotch whisky making that nobody's talking about. Now, you go to American distillers that are serious about flavour, and you will find that they are specifying their casks. They will go to specific cooperages for specific oak varieties, for specific casks, and they will pay the premium for these casks, because they know that the customer will thereafter pay the premium for their product, because they invested in their product. So people want to invest for smell and taste in what they bottle. A lot, majority of Scotch whisky distillers are doing what they can under the circumstances, but never more so than now is the quality of casks wood so important. And this is another thing about nostalgia. And you've probably experienced this. As soon as you start to taste the older generations of whiskies and bourbons and ryes and rums, you're tasting that older generation of cask, and your experience, fueled by nostalgia from the past and the awareness and spontaneous, instinctive, subliminal alertness that is given you, you will pick up on what casks really, really do and really, really mean to the product in which is matured in them. So nostalgia, it's nice, it's sentimental, it's It gives us these golden glow moments, and that's important. But also importantly, the nostalgia for the experience of smell and taste logged in our memory banks, in our library, over the years and the decades, inform the accuracy, the intelligence, and the sensibility of what we are smelling and tasting now. And as time goes on, we just get better. I'm Ralfy. I hope you've enjoyed my little monologue on nostalgia, because it was starting out as something nice and woolly and cosy and sitting in bars and old familiar malts, and that's great. But to actually link it, and nobody else is going to do this. So this is why you come to ralfy.com. This is why you come spend a bit of quality time in the Bothy here, in the middle of the Irish Sea. But it's actually knowing how nostalgia has its own form of intelligence and lets us know and understand how what we are buying is being made and informing our decision to buy. Now, I'm going to conclude now by saying I had a conversation recently with someone, another YouTuber, on a whole different subject. And the other doesn't touch whiskey at all. But we connected one of these wee groups many years ago, wee YouTube groups. And I kind of stayed in touch. And what he was saying is that it's amazing how a shared opinion can inform people and not produce a dramatic result, but start to cause a groundswell and a ground shift. And where he's noticing it is in the sale of items on Amazon. Now, Amazon is a monolithic behemoth. That's the words to describe it. And it's very convenient for a lot of people to buy there, although you frequently find, once you've included postage, that the product may be more expensive than if you bought it elsewhere, which is why if you're buying my book, probably the book depository is going to be, or going direct to the printer, lulu.com, is a better option than buying in Amazon, although it's available in Amazon. I really appreciate everybody who's left me my 5-star rating in Amazon. Thank you, guys. I noticed and I appreciate it. But with the global pandemic COVID-19 situation happening at the moment, we're looking ahead to how this is going to affect the sale and demand of products that we talk about in the near future. And I can already see, in terms of whiskey, there is going to be a race to the bottom on Amazon this November in particular. They're going to have some very cheap single malts which are cheaper than blends. They will, more often than not, be non-age statement, big producer brands that are well recognised and visible, and I doubt the quality is very good. I really, really do. So if you know anyone, because we're all spreading the word here, if you know anyone who is looking to get into whiskey for the first time, if they're going to be completely governed by how cheap they can do it, sure, they could get the bottle in Amazon. I wouldn't be surprised to see £15 a bottle. Seriously, it was £20 last November. I can see it down to £15 for a single malt. That's too cheap. You cannot invest in a product when it's selling that cheaply. You just can't do it. Just saying. And I would recommend that you steer them away from that. That you encourage them to say £25 a bottle, even in the supermarket, something like Glenlivet or Glenfiddich, to start with, to get their bearings. But importantly, the specialist retailers. And finally, to the specialist retailers, if Ralfy happens to review a good whiskey and give it 90 marks of 100, please don't put the price up, because everybody's talking about it and it's losing your business. I thought you'd appreciate the feedback. keep the price the same. Loyalty, customer loyalty, based on your expertise and being informed. The specialist retailers are increasingly under pressure because of the supersizers like Amazon completely undercutting with massive contracts. So as we as buyers, we want to be aware of it and support the small craft distillers who bottle the way a whiskey should be drunk. Unchill-filtered, natural colour, 46.3%. And provide a much more substantial, nostalgic experience in which we can draw on our reserves from the past for the future. I've covered a lot of ground, haven't I? Anyway, cheers, maltmates. Thanks for watching. I hope you'll join me again before too long for Ralfy Review 824. Apple crispness coming through now. I love it when a young whiskey just changes in the glass over time, because as we get more experienced, using all the resources of memory and nostalgia and the rest of it, we spot it more. And when we spot it, we appreciate it. And when we appreciate it, it just makes our moments all the better. Bye.